Heavenly Father, we praise you for speaking to us through Paul's letter to the Philippians. We thank you that you love us and that you want our love to abound. Fill our hearts, Lord, with the love of Jesus and set our hearts and minds on him. We pray this for the glory of his name. Amen. Well, Philippians chapter 1 and verse 9. Paul writes, "And it is my prayer that your love may abound more and more." Love, that is the topic this morning. And it's a topic I bet we all approve of. The Beatles famously sung, "All you need is love," a sentiment that I think everyone can get on board with. And maybe as we hear Paul's prayer for love, well, we are immediately on board. But perhaps we miss the challenge of these verses. And now don't let the gentle-sounding topic fool you. It has bite. Because Paul isn't just praying for love. He's praying for love to abound more and more. He's saying, don't settle just for love. Have love in abundance, love that overflows, that flourishes. Have a love like the Lord Jesus. And this is a prayer of ambition, pushing us not to settle. Paul's aim for us is to not be satisfied with a cruise liner Christianity, a comfortable, cushy Christianity, but instead to long for abounding love, to love like the Lord Jesus. And so my hope is that this morning we'll all want to pray this Paul with prayer. Pray this Paul prayer with Paul. and we'll want to pray that for ourselves and for each other, a prayer that our love would abound. Now I trust you still have your Bibles open to Philippians chapter 1. Are we going to focus on Paul's prayer? So just verses 9 to 11. And there are three parts to Paul's prayer, three elements that expound Paul's prayer for love. Firstly, love that abounds in Jesus. Secondly, love that chooses the excellent. And thirdly, love that's fruitful. So number one, love that abounds in Jesus. Paul prays for love that abounds in Jesus. Chapter 1, verse 9, "And it is my prayer that your love may abound more and more." Now notice, it's not that they, don't have love. His prayer is for abounding love. The Philippian church is a fantastic church. As you read through the letter, we learn how they have partnered with Paul right from the beginning, supporting him and the gospel. In fact, as we read in the opening verses, Paul begins by thanking God for their love and support from the first day until now. And so he's not praying for their love because they're some sort of loveless church. He's praying for their love because he doesn't want them to settle for just love. He wants abounding love. The word Paul uses for abound, it has the sense of to be in excess, to excel, to superabound. And so when I'm picturing this prayer, I'm imagining their love with a superhero cape, faster than a speeding bullet, able to leap tall buildings in a single bound. So you see, Paul's not praying just for love, but for abounding love. It's a love that, it never says that's enough, but it's a love that keeps on giving, that keeps on loving. "It is my prayer that your love may abound more and more." Now notice, Paul gives that abounding love shape or direction. He says, "That your love may abound more and more with knowledge and all discernment." These, if you like, chart the course for our abounding love, knowledge, and all discernment. And it's easier to see that they're giving direction when you replace these words with the opposite qualities. So Paul doesn't pray for ignorance and foolishness, or to be unaware and confused. Our love is to be aimed, it's to have shape. We're not to be undirected in our abounding love, but to be wise, discerning. It's the difference, I think, between a burst water main, pouring water haphazardly into the street, and the firemen skillfully directing their high-pressure water hose to put out a blazing fire. Our abounding love is to be aimed, to be directed, and especially when we think about what Paul means by knowledge and all discernment. The knowledge Paul is talking about is knowing the Lord Jesus. The discernment Paul is talking about is thinking like the Lord Jesus. The Lord Jesus shapes and directs our love. We love what he loves. We love how he loves. This doesn't limit or cap our love. It shapes and directs it. It gives our love the shape of humility, looking outside of ourselves. It's love that's generous and patient, that serves, that's even willing to suffer for the good of others. This is Jesus's abounding love. And it gives our love gospel direction. The gospel all about salvation, bringing people from death to life, calling us to put away sin and to put on Jesus. It's a radical kind of love Paul is calling for. It's a love that God lifts up and exalts. It's the love of our Lord Jesus. Paul doesn't want us to settle for just love. Paul wants our love abounding more and more in the love of Jesus. Now, Paul prays for love that abounds with knowledge and all discernment. He says, so that, and now we're getting on to point two, so that we choose what is excellent. Love that chooses what is excellent. Now, I want us to notice that this ever-increasing love, well, it's not an end in itself, but in fact a means to an end. Paul prays for abounding love with knowledge and discernment so that you may approve what is excellent. Are there super love directed by knowing and thinking like Jesus is so that they would choose what is best. Paul isn't saying that they become like a judge in the high dive competition, waiting for the dive and then putting up a score. He's talking about choosing for themselves what best serves the gospel. It's the kind of thinking that goes beyond the simple question of, well, what's wrong and what's acceptable? And instead asks, what can I do that's best for the gospel? Now, when I speak, I know I shouldn't lie, curse, or gossip. But what should I spend my time talking about? What would be best? When I spend my money, I know I should be responsible, take care of my finances, and put money towards helping make Jesus known. But do I stop and ask, what would be the excellent use of my money? What about when it comes to relationships? I know I should love my family and spend time with them, but do I stop to think and pray about what would be best for them? How could I best serve them to build them up in Christ? And so you see how this is a step up in our thinking, going from what's acceptable to what's excellent, what's best for the gospel. Paul prays for abounding love so that we choose what is excellent. And I think we need that abounding love in order to choose what is excellent. Without love, I know I'd settle for what's easy, what's comfortable, or what's convenient. In fact, often I do settle. But this prayer is ambitious, and it calls for a massive change in attitude, fueled by an abounding love. In the business world, it's the difference, I think, between a wage worker and a partner. The difference between doing enough for your wage and the partner who's always seeking improvements, always looking for opportunities to serve, always looking to choose what is excellent. Now, Paul says in this prayer, in this letter, that we are partners in all of life, working together to advance the gospel. And no matter what situation God has put us in, whether we're students, workers, retired, or anywhere in between, with abounding love, we can choose what is excellent and best serve the gospel. Now, Paul prays that we choose what is excellent in how we conduct ourselves in public and in private, in where we want to live and at what cost, in the jobs we take, that we choose what is excellent in how we treat our spouses and raise our children, in how we use our time and our financial resources. This is an all-of-life prayer. Paul prays that we choose what is excellent, that we choose what maximizes gospel advance, even when it's costly, and even when it looks foolish, and even when it's hard. So point one, Paul prays for abounding love in Jesus. Point two, Paul prays for love that chooses what is excellent. And now point three, the final step in the prayer. Paul prays for love that's fruitful. Paul gives the result of choosing what is excellent in the last part of his prayer. Paul prays for super abounding love so that they approve what is excellent. And so in verse 10, take a look with me at verse 10. And so be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ, to the glory and praise of God. Paul's image here is of the day Jesus returns, the day of Christ. And having been choosing what is best, we report back to him having grown spiritually. Now pure and not mixed or double-minded, blameless rather than blemished, and surrounded, he says, with a bountiful harvest, filled with the fruit of righteousness. It's a beautiful picture, a day of celebration and joy. It's a bit like prize-giving day, where all our efforts are laid out, and we get to celebrate and enjoy all that the Lord has done in us and through us. You know, I'm picturing a harvest day celebration, where all of the farmers bring in their best produce, plump pumpkins and watermelons, juicy mangoes and peaches. Perhaps Paul can bring in some of his lettuce. It's fruit in abundance for us to enjoy. And maybe you're wondering, well, what is that fruit of righteousness? And I think to put it simply, it's all the good that comes from living for Jesus. It's the good that comes from a husband loving his wife and children, doing what's best for them. It's the good that comes from a Bible study group member looking out for and encouraging their group week in and week out. It's the good that comes from a church family loving each other, helping each other, building one another up in Jesus. But it's not only that. It's the life lived for Jesus that testifies to his greatness, the life that invites people to taste and see that the Lord is good, that reaches out with the gospel. It's the church that welcomes the outsider, that has a real heart for the lost. So I think it's not just building us up in quality, but building us up in quantity as well. It's the building us up that adds to the number who praise Jesus. Because, of course, Jesus, well, he's worth it, isn't he? And so the fruit that comes from this prayer, well, it's each of us built up encouraged and equipped to serve and love him. And it's also the additional people, the numbers that are brought in to hear the gospel and who put their trust in him. This picture of the harvest, all the fruit, it's meant to encourage us, to say it's all worth it for Jesus. That's the product of a love that abounds in Jesus, the result of choosing what's best for the gospel, a bountiful harvest, all to the glory and praise of God. Now that's the end of the prayer, but do you see how the three parts fit together? For a bumper harvest when Jesus returns, we need to choose what is excellent. And to choose what is excellent, we need to abound in Jesus' love. That's Paul's prayer for us this morning. So what do you think? There's more than meets the eye with this prayer. A prayer for love can sound, I think, so innocent, but this is a big prayer. A prayer not just for love, but for abounding love. A prayer not just for what's acceptable, but for what's excellent. A prayer not for settling for where we're at, but aiming for a bountiful harvest, a church bursting with fruit. It's a huge prayer for us this morning. Don Carson, writing on this prayer, said, "What is immediately clear is that Paul's prayer spells the death of entrenched mediocrity, of smug self-satisfaction, of contentment with our own excuses. Paul prays for what is excellent." It's a massive transformation Paul is praying for. It's a call to desire spiritual growth, not just being satisfied with where we're at or where we've been, but instead pressing on, actively pursuing spiritual growth, no matter our age or stage, all the while humbling ourselves, depending on Jesus for his love to abound in us, his guidance to direct us, and for him to grow and provide spiritual fruit in us. That's the kind of thing Paul is praying for, that kind of love, that kind of thinking. It's the kind of thinking that had Paul rejoicing in prison, rejoicing because the whole prison knew he was in jail for Christ. And so his imprisonment, well, it advanced the gospel. Just think of all the ministry he'd already done up to this point in his life, and yet he's still pressing on as he approaches his death. Back in New Zealand, I knew of an elderly man living in a care home, and he had problems with his back and with his neck. And so anytime he had to go anywhere, he had to be wheeled around. But he said, everywhere he goes, he smiles, ear to ear, massive smile. And then people ask him, "Why do you smile so much?" And he gets to tell them all about Jesus. And that gives him great joy. You can see the smile on his face as he told me about it. The care home he was living in had a monthly church service, and here is this man, can't go anywhere by himself, and yet his prolific inviting was responsible, well, for most of the people that went along to hear the gospel. That is a love that abounds more and more, that chooses what is excellent, and that is producing a bountiful harvest. This is what this prayer is asking for. That kind of love, that kind of thinking. It's asking us how we're going to spend our days and months and years. It's a prayer for decision. How are we going to use our work or our study? If we're coming up to retirement, how are we going to use it to serve the good news of Jesus? It's asking how are we going to use our hands? How are we going to use our voice? This prayer, well, it's asking a lot of us. Except, well, we've got to remember, it's a prayer, a big prayer to our even bigger God. It's asking a lot, and it's asking it from God. The love Paul prays for, well, it's the love that first abounded in Christ for us. The love that abounded all the way to the cross for us. The love that didn't settle for what is right and acceptable, but chose what is excellent. The love that's been producing a harvest 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. That is the love Paul is praying for us. So maybe the Beatles had it right all along. All you do need is love. But not just any kind of love. Jesus' love. The love that is ours in Christ. If you've received his love, his abounding love, well then that's just the kind of love at work in you right now. Now as we come to a close, well let's ask God for Jesus' love to abound in us. I'd like us to do something a little bit different, and I want us to pray this prayer together now. Let's pray it for ourselves and for each other. So let's stand and we'll pray it together. We'll pray it to each other, just like we would the grace. And so let's pray together from verse 9 to the end of verse 11. Let's pray. And it is my prayer that your love may abound more and more with knowledge and all discernment, so that you may approve what is excellent, and so be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ, to the glory and praise of God. Amen. Well, amen.